Good afternoon, everyone. Please mark your attendance by sending yes in the chat box. And I have shared screen. So if screen is not visible, then you can listen. So up to last lecture, we have covered so much topic on linear independent vectors, and just in the last lecture we have defined new concept basis. So lemma, theorems are discussed there. One of the lemma is there, if any set of vectors which are linearly independent there in the vector space, then every element in their linear span can be written uniquely there. Then theorem that we have discussed about the coronary 1, 2 and 3. So what was the statement of the theorem? In that theorem we have seen the statement that if any set of vectors is there in vector space, finite number of vectors v1, v2 up to vn, then either they are linearly independent or sum of vector can be written as a linear combination in terms of its predecessors. And then corollary 1 is very important that we have derived from the theorem. So corollary 1 tells us that if you have any set of vectors, finite number of vectors whose linear span is capital W, then you can find out its subset which consists in it linearly independent elements and whose linear span is also same W. Then second corollary, I think it is for is it for finite dimensional vector space? What was the statement of corollary second? If you have some vectors whose linear span is nothing but the capital V, then its finite subset is there which spans also capital V. I think this is the statement. Let me check it. Corollary second, yes, it is for finite dimension. Okay, corollary one we have defined for any vector space, and then corollary second is nothing but the for finite dimensional. So if any vector space is finite dimensional, then it contains finite subset which spans capital V, whose linear span is capital V and which contains a finite number of elements in it. This corollary second we have proved for finite dimensional vector space. And then after that we have defined the definition of basis. What is meant by basis? What is meant by basis for any vectors, any vector space I am saying, not only for finite dimensional. If V is any vector space, then any subset, any finite subset of it forms a basis for vector space if that finite subset is such that it contains in it linearly independent element and their linear span is nothing but the whole V. Or in other words, if any set you have to call as a basis for vector space, then you must have in this way all the elements in that set are nothing but the linearly independent, and every element of vector space can be uniquely written as a linear combination of all that linearly independent elements. So such a set you can say as a basis for vector space V. So this is the concept of basis. Wait for a minute, I have bad network in my connection. Okay, so we continue. Then after defining basis, we have rewritten this statement of Corollary second. Corollary second tells us that if V is finite dimensional vector space, then it contains in it finite subset whose elements are linearly independent and whose linear span is nothing but the capital V. And then in corollary 3, we have to state same statement but in terms of basis. So if V is a finite dimensional vector space, then it has a basis of finite number of elements. So some subset of finite number of elements is there for finite dimensional vector space, which forms a basis for same vector space there. So these are the corollaries there. And now again I have to discuss some more concepts, and then I have to prove one exercise in today's lecture. So see, in the corollary 3 we are saying for finite dimensional vector space some subset is there which forms a basis for vector space. That means every element of vector space can be written as a linear combination of elements of that finite subset of finite dimensional vector space. But already we have proved one again let me tell you that in corollary 3 vector space is finite dimensional, some subset is there for finite dimensional vector space whose linear span is nothing but the V and which contains in it linearly independent elements. So that finite subset forms basis for finite dimensional vector space, but it contains linearly independent elements in it. One lemma we have proved, and just I have revised it. What was the statement? If some finite number of elements are there in vector space which are linearly independent, then every element in the linear span of linearly independent element have a unique representation. म्हणजे वेक्टर स्पेसचा प्रत्येक एलिमेंट हा युनिकली रिप्रेझेंट करता येईल तुम्हाला इन टर्म्स ऑफ बेसिस एलिमेंट्स, बिकॉज बेसिस एलिमेंट्स आर लिनियरली इंडिपेंडेंट. बेसिस एलिमेंट्स आर नथिंग बट दी लिनियरली इंडिपेंडेंट. सो एव्हरी एलिमेंट इन दी वेक्टर स्पेस, पर्टिक्युलरली आय एम सेइंग फॉर फायनाइट डायमेन्शनल वेक्टर स्पेस, कॅन बी रिप्रेझेंटेड युनिकली एज अ लिनियर कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ बेसिस एलिमेंट्स. So keep in mind hereafter, when you say that any set as a basis for vector space, then every element of vector space can be represented uniquely as linear combination of basis elements, because basis elements are already linearly independent, so uniqueness is there in their representation. Is it clear to everyone? Is it clear to everyone? I have discussion particularly for finite dimensional vector space, but I have to take that discussion again. But before that, I have to prove one exercise which is true for any vector space that have a basis of n elements. That I have to prove firstly, and then later on I have to again take discussion for finite dimensional vector spaces. So is it clear to everyone concept of basis of vector space? So 10 minutes we have taken revision, now let me continue. Okay, I'm now going to write on the screen. Let me change. Okay. This is the corollary 3 that we have finished in the last lecture. If V is finite dimensional vector space and U1, U2, U1 span V, then some subset of this, some subset of spanning set is nothing but the basis. And we are directly saying basis, that means that subset contains in it linearly independent elements. Just made I think this Microsoft OneNet giving us problem. Wait for a minute. This node is not responding to us. So I have to take exercise. This exercise is nothing but the capital V as basis of n elements. If capital V as basis of n elements, then prove that the vector space V is isomorphic to FN. Okay, take this exercise. For example, if capital V, by default capital V now we are taking as a vector spacer, so no need to say each and every time that V is vector space. So if capital V has basis of n elements, if capital V has a basis, just we have studied this concept of basis, we have introduced it. If capital V has a basis of n elements, I don't know here in this exercise V is finite dimensional or not finite dimensional. We are taking arbitrary vector space, so no need to say it is finite dimensional. If capital V has a basis of n elements, yesterday we have not written here elements. Okay. If capital V has a basis of n elements, then prove that capital V, capital V is isomorphic isomorphic to Fn. At this exercise, if capital V has a basis of n elements, then prove that capital V is isomorphic to Fn. I am going to prove this exercise, and then I am giving to you just another statement for finite dimensional. This statement is true always for finite dimensional vector space, that vector space, finite dimensional vector space is always isomorphic to Fn, because we know finite dimensional vector space always possesses their basis. Just we have proved in corollary 3, if V is finite dimensional vector space, then it has a basis. It has a basis because it is finite dimensional. Linear span of that finite set is nothing but the V itself, and that subset of linear span or subset of that finite set is nothing but the forming their basis for finite dimensional vector space. So I am going to prove here this exercise for any arbitrary vector space, and then it is by default true for finite dimensional vector space. Same proof you can write for the finite dimensional. So later on I discuss the thing for finite dimensional vector space. Let me prove now this exercise. So write in the solution or proof of this exercise. In this exercise we want to take proof. We want to prove that V is isomorphic to Fn. So you can write proof or you can write solution. Now you can write here, let V, capital V, be a vector space, and let, okay, it is given to us, V has a basis of n elements. So I am directly going to take that n elements in the basis. And let small v1, v2, you can say this is set, or you can just write in this list elements. And let v1, v2 up to vn be a basis. Be a basis of capital V, vector space capital V. Okay. Just we have taken discussion. We discussed there that if basis is there for any vector space, then every element of vector space can be uniquely represented as linear combination of basis elements. I am saying in terms of basis elements, because what is meant by basis? Basis is nothing but the spanning set. Basis is nothing but the spanning set whose elements are nothing but the linearly independent. Because basis is spanning set of capital V, each and every element of capital V can be written as a linear combination of these basis elements V1, V2 up to Vn. And because basis elements are linearly independent, we know in linear span of linearly independent elements, each element has a unique representation. That means these basis elements are linearly independent, so linear span of this basis element has a unique representation. Or every element in their linear span is nothing but the unique representation. That means now, if you take V1, V2 up to Vn as a basis for vector space, so every element of vector space can be written as a linear combination of these basis elements, and that linear combination is nothing but the unique there. So each and every element of capital V can be uniquely represented as linear combination of basis elements. Okay. So I am going to write now here. Since I am continuing here, since small v1, v2 up to vn is a basis for the vector space. No need to write vector space, you can directly write V also. Is a basis for a vector space V, comma, each element small v belonging to capital V is uniquely represented since this each element V can be one. Instead of this E, you can write can be uniquely represented as a linear combination uniquely represented as a linear combination of V1, V2, Vn, and thus for small v belongs to capital V, small v can be written as alpha 1 v1, alpha 2 v2, up to alpha n vn. Alpha i's are belonging to field F. This set of scalars is unique for the representation of small v. Small v can be represented with the help of only alpha 1, alpha 2, up to alpha n, and not with the help of other scalars. This is the use of basis elements. You can represent each element of vector space uniquely in the linear combination of these basis elements v1, v2, up to vn. They are linearly independent, and these scalars are nothing but the unique alpha 1, alpha 2, up to alpha n. For the representation of small v, you can use only this set of scalars alpha 1, alpha 2, up to alpha n. Okay. Now, with the help of v has a basis of n elements, we have written this discussion there. Now, what we want to prove here? We want to prove v is isomorphic to Fn. You know what is meant by Fn. Do you know Fn? Fn, already we have proved this as a very second example. Fn, capital F is nothing but the any field, and Fn is nothing but the vector space over that field F. What are the elements of Fn? Fn contains in it all the order n tuples. And what are the elements that we are using while writing that order n tuples? They are nothing but the scalars. In the first position, it is alpha 1. Order n tuple in that parenthesis alpha 1 comma alpha 2 up to alpha n. These type of elements are there in the Fn. And we know everything about Fn. How we add two elements of Fn, alpha 1, alpha 2 up to alpha n, then beta 1, beta 2 up to beta n. This can be added in this way. New element is nothing but the alpha 1 plus beta 1 in this first position, alpha 2 plus beta 2 in the second position. In this way, alpha n plus beta n. This is the addition. And second operation in the vector space Fn is alpha into element of Fn is nothing but the alpha 1, alpha 2 up to alpha n. So you have to simply multiply to each scalar by alpha, and then it forms new tuple, n tuple, and this is the element there. Huh? And how we equate any two elements of Fn? We equate corresponding elements. Everything is known to you about this Fn that already we have proved there. It is vector space over F. And now if V has basis of n elements, then it is always isomorphic to Fn. These two vector spaces are isomorphic. Fn is known vector space, V is any arbitrary vector space, but we have information about this V only that it has basis of n elements. So if V has basis of n elements, then it is always isomorphic to Fn. Fn is nothing but the known vector space. So we want to prove here V is isomorphic to Fn. That means we must have their mapping from V to Fn, which is homomorphism, vector space homomorphism. which should be one to one, which should be on two, and that mapping is well defined firstly. So if everything is there for these two vector spaces, for this mapping between these two vector spaces, then we can say there that this vector space V is isomorphic to Fn. So let us start to write proof of this, that V is isomorphic to Fn. So there is some mapping from V to, okay, so I am going to define there. Okay, now I am writing here what we want to prove. To prove capital V is isomorphic to Fn. Okay. So define. Okay, from vector space to vector space, we generally use this type of mappings. Capital T, I am saying here, capital T is mapping from V to Fn. I am defining mapping T, I am denoting it by T from V to Fn. And I have to give definition by small v. I am taking any arbitrary element of capital V as small v, and I am applying there capital T. But firstly, I am before taking its image, I am saying here that this v is nothing but the small v is represented as alpha 1 v 1, alpha 2 v 2, up to, we know because of basis, every element of vector space can be represented as a linear combination of v1, v2 up to vn by taking some set of scalars. And this is V. I am writing another form of V, and then I am taking image here under this T. I have not taken it image. I have firstly taken any small v from capital V. I have given another form for that small v in terms of basis elements v1, v2 up to vn. And now I am going to define this T. I am just taking, with the help of this combination, I am taking here image of this element as this order n tuple, because we want in the second set Fn order n tuples. Elements of Fn are nothing but the order n tuples. So with the help of these scalars that we are using in this linear combination, we are forming this type of order n tuple, and then I am saying this is the element of Fn. So we have taken image of this small v as alpha 1, alpha 2 up to alpha n, and which is finally element of this Fn. And this is nothing but the for all small v belongs to capital V. Okay. I want to prove V is isomorphic to Fn. That means we must have one mapping from V to Fn, which should be vector space homomorphism, and then it is one to one and then on two, to say that these two are nothing but the isomorphic to each other. So we have taken from capital V, which is vector space which has n elements in its basis. So small v we have taken, and we are taking image of that small v under T as nothing but the order n tuple. And this is nothing but the final element of that Fn. So we have taken definition of T in this way. We have taken definition of T in this way. And now I have to say there that our mapping is well defined. We have to discuss about the well definedness. Then one-to-one on-to-ness, and it is vector space homomorphism. Then after doing everything, we can say T is isomorphic. Just let me know that you are getting this definition or not, clearly or not. You are understanding this definition of T that I have taken from capital V to Fn. For the capital V, there its elements are nothing but of this form, small v, w, etc. And for Fn on another side, elements of Fn are nothing but the order n tuples. So I am just matching these elements under this T. For V, its image under T is nothing but the order n tuple. But how I am taking that image, I am just taking in the linear combination of that small v in terms of v1, v2, vn basis elements. I am taking that scalars and I am just writing that scalars in that order, and then it forms order interval. Finally, it is element of F. And then we have to continue through whatever mapping we have written here. So now let me discuss everything about this mapping. One by one. So first I have to clear that our mapping is nothing but the well defined. This mapping we have defined, so we must check this mapping is well defined or not. So T is well defined. Okay. I am just writing in one line that T is nothing but the well defined. So the uniqueness of that representation of V. Okay. Since every element of capital V, every element of capital V can be represented. Can be represented uniquely. Can be represented uniquely as a linear combination of linear combination of basis elements. Comma, the map P is well defined. See how I am checking well definedness of this mapping. I am just saying here that each element of capital V can be written uniquely. What is in my well definedness of mapping? You have to just check this forms mapping or not, or it is function. I am in algebra part, so I am saying here each and every time mapping. You can also say function. When we say that any rule as a function or mapping, if you take from the first set on which we are defining mapping any element, then you must have unique element in the second set, which is image of this element. So because small v can be written uniquely, that means you have to use in the while writing v as a linear combination of v1, v2 up to vn, you are just using alpha1, alpha2, alpha n. There is no another set of scalars. So image of this small v under t is nothing but the only alpha1, alpha2, alpha n, and not other order interval beta1, beta2 up to beta n. And it happens because of uniqueness of this linear combination of this small v. Small v can be written as a uniquely as a linear combination of v1, v2 up to vn. That means you are just using this set of scalars alpha1, alpha2 up to alpha n while representing small v in terms of v1, v2 up to vn. That means when you take image of this linear combination under T, you will get on another side only one order n tuple alpha1, alpha2 up to alpha n, and not other order n tuple for the same element. That means for each element in the first set, you are relating this each element of the first set with at most one element or unique element in the second set under this mapping T. That means mapping T is nothing but the well defined. So mapping T is well defined. Okay. And now I have to prove 1-to-1 less of nothing. So second, T is T is 1-to-1 inverse also. So suppose so let small u comma v are, or let me write inverse, let u comma v be any two elements, any two elements of capital V. I'm just writing any two elements. I don't know they are distinct or equal. Then, because these are the elements of vector space V, which has basis of n elements, then U can be written as alpha 1 V 1, alpha 2 V 2, alpha n V n. For alpha 1, alpha 2, up to alpha n belonging to F. Again, small v is nothing but the element of vector space, so it can be written as uniquely as a linear combination of v1. Small v is element of vector space. So it can be written as a linear combination of v1, v2 up to vn by taking some unique scalars, and that scalars I am taking here beta 1, beta 2 up to beta n, n scalars, and here in this case beta i's are nothing but the scalars. Okay, just we have taken two elements of vector space because they are elements of this vector space which has basis of n elements, so they can be written uniquely as a linear combination of this basis elements v1, v2, up to vn by taking unique scalars there. Okay. And now I am going to consider equal images. Consider image of U is same as image of V under T. Then it implies, what is U? You know what is U? Alpha 1 V1, alpha 2 V2, up to alpha n Vn. So you can write image of U as, by definition of T, what is the definition of T on U? U can be written as alpha 1 V1, alpha 2 V2, up to alpha n Vn. So its image must be alpha 1, alpha 2 up to alpha n. And what is Vn? V, while writing representation of V, you have used here, or we have used here, betas. So image of this is nothing but the beta 1, beta 2 up to beta n. Okay. I am writing the same step here. I have taken ut and vt from the second set. Ut belongs to fn, vt belongs to fn. But meaning for ut or image of u under t is nothing but this element, this order interval, because we are using alpha 1, alpha 2 in representation of u. And in the representation of v, we are using beta 1, beta 2. So we are taking this order intervals. And these two order intervals are the elements in Fn, which is vector space, but make clear that in Fn these two elements are equal if and only if So these two elements are equal. That means from Fn, information from Fn, you can use to equate this. This gives us, because these two order intervals are same, so you can equate these corresponding elements. And this is the case in that Fn, you can equate this to each corresponding elements here in this order intervals. And because you are equating this, scalars are same here because of these two order intervals, or because you are taking two images are equal. So in this case, now you can say alpha 1 v1 plus alpha 2 v2 up to alpha n vn. Let me first tell you, already you know how to show any mapping as a one-to-one. Mainly there are two definitions. You can take two distinct elements from first set, and you can prove their images are also distinct. This is the first way to prove any mapping as a one-to-one. And we are using second way here. What is second way to prove any mapping as a one-to-one? Take from the second set for that mapping, from the second set, two equal images, and prove that their three images are nothing but the equal. So this is the second way to prove any mapping as a one-to-one. So I am using that second way to prove this capital T is nothing but the one-to-one. For that, we have taken two equal images from the second set. We have taken two equal elements from the second set, UT and VT, and then we are proceeding. So I am writing now alpha 1 V1 plus alpha 2 V2 up to alpha n Vn equal to, but alpha 1 is same as beta 1. So you can replace alpha 1 by beta 1. Alpha 2 is same as beta 2. Alpha n is same as beta n. So we have replaced all this. And this two elements tells us that, what is this element? Alpha 1 V1 up to alpha n Vn, this is U. And what is this beta 1 V1 plus beta 2 up to beta n Vn? This is nothing but the V. So by considering UT equals to VT, we got here U equals to V for this mapping T. Thus, UT is equals to VT, that means images of these two elements, equal images, implies U is equals to V for all U comma V in capital V. Therefore, because of these calculations, you can say therefore T is 1-to-1. You can write in this way also, 1-to-1. So in this way we have proved mapping T is nothing but the 1-to-1. So just quickly reply me, you understood this or not? Please reply. I have proved with the help of second definition of one-to-one mapping that our T is the one-to-one. So you understood this or not? And then next we have to, in the third part, we have to prove T is nothing but the ontogen. So think on it, how we prove ontogenes. If the mapping onto the apply session can apply to, and find to download attendance. Okay, how we prove ontoness of any mapping, or in particular for our T, we take one arbitrary element from the second set and we try to find out element, at least one element in the first vector space, first set, whose image is nothing but the element that we have chosen arbitrarily from the second set under the mapping capital T. So we have to take arbitrary element now from the let me know screen is visible or not, because I am getting here problem about that sharing. Is screen visible? Yes, okay. So let me continue. If there is any problem about screen, then you can. Okay, continue. Third, for ontoness, in the third part, we want T is onto. Okay. So let us take any arbitrary element from second vector space. Let suppose I am taking here alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha n from second set, it is fn. Okay. Okay, we have taken one arbitrary element alpha 1, order interval alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha n from second set. Now we have basis in the vector space V, whose elements are v1, v2 up to vn. Now we are going to take their combination of this alpha 1. We have taken fn from fn, this order interval, that means we have alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha n. So I am using that alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha n, and v1, v2 up to vn. Alpha 1, v1, alpha 2, v2 up to alpha n, vn. Okay, because v1, v2 up to vn, they are basis elements. Finally, they are elements of vector space. Alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha n that we have chosen in that order interval. So we have this alpha 1, alpha 2 up to alpha n. If you take this type of combination, then it belongs to vector space. I am giving name to this combination as a V. Finally, it belongs to capital V. Then this total combination belongs to capital V, and its image under capital T. Okay, we have called this combination as a small v. So now I am taking, it is finally element of capital V. Now I am taking under capital T its image, image of V under T. But what is V? It is alpha 1, V1, alpha 2, V2 up to alpha n, Vn under T. But by definition of capital T, what is image for this type of combination? It is order interval alpha 1, alpha 2 up to alpha n. And this is the case to say that capital T is nothing but the onto. For capital T to be onto, we have taken one arbitrary element from fn, and then for that arbitrary element, we got one element, at least one element in the first set whose image under capital T is nothing but again that element that we have chosen arbitrarily. So these are the calculations to say that capital T is nothing but the onto. Thus, I am saying here capital T is onto. Capital T is onto. So this is the proof of onto-ness. So I think I have to stop today here. Listen what I am saying. Which part is remaining to complete this exercise? Now we have to prove capital T is nothing but the vector space homomorphism. So I think you must try for remaining part. So take this. Already we have defined this mapping VT is equal to that order interval. In this is the definition of mapping. You just need their definition to prove everything there. So using this definition, you have to prove for homework that T is nothing but the vector space homomorphism. You can refer previous examples or some proofs are there in which we have proved any mapping as nothing but the vector space homomorphism. Just keep in mind, first set is nothing but the our capital V and second set is nothing but the Fn. Elements of Fn are nothing but the order interpols, and elements of capital V can be written uniquely as a linear combination of V1, V2 up to Vn. If you complete it, then I will check in the next lecture, or you can send me on WhatsApp. Or in the next lecture, I have to complete this proof again. You have to just check you are right or not by comparing both the proofs there. So I am saying you have to complete remaining part at as a homework there. So now I have to stop lecture. So I am stopping lecture now. You can leave now this meeting.